Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Abu Dhabi Bar Mitzvah, Fear and Love in the Modern Middle East, by Adam Valen Levinson, narrated by Vikas Adam. 100 reasons clamor for your going. You go to touch on human identities, to people an empty map. You have a notion that this is the world's heart. You go because you are still young and crave excitement. You go because you are old and need to understand something before it's too late. You go to see what will happen. Colin Thubron, Shadow of the Silk Road. So have they not traveled through the earth and have hearts by which to reason and ears by which to hear? For indeed, it is not eyes that are blinded, but blinded are the hearts which are within the breasts. The Holy Quran, Chapter 22, Verse 46.
What the fuck are you doing in Afghanistan?
A friend. Author's note. Everything in between quotations is verbatim. Transcriptions are taken almost exclusively from audio recordings and occasionally from handwritten or hand-tapped notes in the moment. A very few names have been changed. Preamble. I keep telling myself it was worth it. 23 countries, depending on who did the counting. Most of my first job earnings pilfered to see them, except for what I locked in an IRA because I thought I was an adult. Just before I left America, I left my heart in San Francisco and then Skyped with it. For 534 days of summer, I spent the warm weeks of the Arab Spring in and out of my apartment in Abu Dhabi. I keep telling myself I've grown, that I've answered the questions I needed answered, and that I've learned to ask better questions. I keep telling myself to stop telling myself things. Fresh out of college, I fled the pressures of decision-making and friend-to-friend comparisons and the bleak job market under the cover of idealism. I would explore. I would learn about the world 9/11 made us fear, and I would justify my roving lusts with stories of why we needn't fear it. I wouldn't purely explore, though. I wouldn't follow my childhood friend Danny to Syria, as we'd decided before federal grants told us both no, just to hone our Arabic and steep in the Middle East. I'd work in the Emirates, the country where Dubai was, and oil-rich Abu Dhabi. When I made landfall in a new place, its name familiar from wartime datelines, the pictures in my head matched both fully and not at all. Simple truths came wrapped in complexities I didn't understand, and every time I thought I'd learned something solid, it went soft in my sweaty palms. Impressions and new truths jabbed at each other like skittish kids on a playground and tumbled out as jokey stories in hotel bars. "You'll end up dead," my friend said as I window-shopped flights to Beirut or Damascus or Kabul, laughing or shouting or shaking their heads. But I kept not ending up there. It seemed something was really wrong with our predictions. "Go here! Don't go here!" I'd hear. And I'd listen until I really didn't want to, until the curiosity outweighed the risk, until I felt I could climb one rung higher on the ladder of forbidden nations. Part 1. The Abu Dhabi Bar Mitzvah. Is it the same to feel you must do something as to feel you cannot do anything else? Calvin Lax Cole. Some of its parts. Chapter 1. In the Air. What is above, my dog? We were mostly Americans on the flight out of Chicago, crossing Greenland and Sweden, passing over Lithuania and Turkey, then Iran. No one had taken advantage of Etihad Airlines' Falcon policy, by which a bird of prey is permitted at merely 3 times the cost of an extra checked bag. 2 more are welcome, if you buy them a seat. With no such distractions, I watched the Chinese game show Just Go and felt the world grow small. It was just as terrible as American TV, and just as glorious. "Juice?" said the pretty attendant in a pretty hat, balancing 3 glasses on a tray, 2 of them shades of orange. "What's the orange one?" I asked.
"It's orange," she said.
Clearly, I didn't belong.
Obviously, one of the oranges was orange, or had even that been too hasty an assumption? I took the glass of the mystery orange and a tentative nip. It was fitting, in a way. The root of the Arabic for carrot, juzr, is shared by the words for island and peninsula, as in the Arabian Peninsula or the island of Abu Dhabi. Of course, it was total coincidence in that place where linguistic bloodlines run tangled back into ancient history, but as we headed toward Jazirat al-Arab, I couldn't help but imagine our destination like a great carrot on the map. I had never been much for going with the flow, but a certain flow had brought me here. I left high school dreaming of Russian study and Hebrew and modern Greek, languages I connected to through ancestors once or twice removed and thought sounded sexy. But in the last 4 years, I had hardly questioned why I spent my first week of college auditing 2 Arabic classes in the hope of winning a spot. Consciously, in my only moment of choice, I just thought it would be fun. My cousins in Jerusalem thought I was mental. When I talked to Itai in his camp at the Negev at officer's school in the Israeli army, where he trained boys younger than we were to train boys younger than they were, I could hear him shaking his head over the wire. "I just don't get it. Why don't you learn Hebrew?" "Because you speak English," I said. In a windowless below-ground classroom uptown, my elementary Arabic class met 4 times per week for 75 minutes. 7 miles from the deadliest attack ever on American soil, the study of this language, the official tongue of the religion claimed by these attackers, carried a special emotional charge. There were native speakers of Arabic dialects unversed in the literary language, political scientists, Hebrew-speaking Jews, and total neophytes like me, and no one denied the impression that this was a language that represented a certain opposition, that it was on the other side of something. Many of us were drawn in because we were nosy, and we looked for bridges across the murky gap. Downtown, 5 years earlier, 9/11 had forced Arab and Muslim and Middle Eastern onto the airwaves. It was wartime with rhetoric to match, and the battle lines of our new enemies were painted with huge, clumsy brushstrokes. The attack had made us all forcefully self-conscious. We perceived them, assumed their perceptions of us, and then canceled all the flights to Beirut. But by learning the primary language of this region, some of us thought, we might be able to figure out what them were really thinking. Learning to spell Salam Aleikum seemed like a good place to start. I was hooked long before I felt the language let fall the first of its veils, revealing morphology as finely calibrated as the engine of a race car. From the words to know, Alama, we can divine through patterns, to teach, to make know, Alama, to learn, to make oneself know, Ta'alama, to inquire, to seek to know, Ista'alama, scholar, a knower, Alim, and information, the knowns, Ma'alumat. And in the reverse, the unknown is knowable if we can recognize the root. A little familiarity can go a long way. Of course, we often guess wrong. That word for scholar, alim, usually means world. To live in Arabic is to live in a labyrinth of false turns and double meanings, Jonathan Rabin wrote in Arabia Through the Looking Glass. No sentence means quite what it says. Every word is potentially a talisman, conjuring the ghosts of the entire family of words from which it comes. Its trademark haziness can only be cleared, as far as it will ever be cleared, by knowing as many members of that family as possible. And yet, the language unfolds even through the missteps, and as we skitter along the web of rules and quirks, the ghosts of Rabin's Arabic come quickly out into the daylight. But there are other traps. In school, from a Moroccan teacher or a Tunisian or a Syrian, we learned modern standard Arabic, known as Fusa, from a root that means to be eloquent. MSA is the official language of 24 countries and is spoken nowhere. Formal Arabic is the native tongue only of television, but only the news, and print. Everywhere else, regional dialect takes over, complete with homegrown rules of conjugation, syntax, vocabulary, and pronunciation. As a saving grace, MSA is understood far more widely than it is used. School children learn the formalities of case endings and the sounds of the official language, but it's like putting scaffolding on a building that's already finished. When you begin to speak with a newscaster's diction, they'll get it. The news sounds like you, after all. But with every word you say, you'll say more than you mean. And less. Studying in our underground vacuum, we practiced a kind of childlike curiosity, abstract and theoretical, and not yet made to answer to the strictures of real life. Soon, it would be. Arab friends tittered when I said something in Fusha outside the classroom. Say it again. To them, it sounds like you're speaking in Elizabethan English, my Moroccan professor told us. Then, he continued to teach us how to sound like Shakespeare. By graduation, the bits of my identity I could put a finger on were well muddled in the labyrinth of that mild geographic focus. Some Arabic language, political science courses that hinted at the region, too many visits to the falafel shop on Broadway that closed for sanitary violations. You love the Middle East, don't you? Someone asked me in the May drizzle at commencement. I didn't know what to say. College hadn't given me the tongue-tip arsenal of quotations to pluck off as needed, and I looked for more words as we lined up behind St. Paul's Chapel. If I'd been to more weddings, I might have looked to the chapel and seen a clue. In that same Paul's first epistle to the Corinthians, the nuptially overworked chapter 13, he writes, "Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres." If looking for true things was love, then I loved, and I did so with the bias of a faint hope. 77 years earlier in Washington, a Bible lay open to that same page. As he would on three such occasions over the next dozen years, FDR put his hand over these words. Love, perhaps at the first joint. Hope, maybe at the knuckle. Under his palm, it said, "When I was a child, I talked like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I put the ways of childhood behind me." And then, the man in a morning coat and striped trousers was made president of the United States. "The only thing we have to fear is fear itself," he said then. Nameless, unreasoning, unjustified terror which paralyzes needed efforts to convert retreat into advance. All that in a 4-page speech. While he spoke of facing fear, his hand was grounded in love. I still loved the Middle East like a child, I could have said. I still reasoned like a child with the blackened memories of a September Tuesday in 8th grade when the headmaster told us to go home. My father was home early, too. He hugged me, and in the one extra moment we lingered, I knew everything had changed. But I had no idea how, my reason clouded by fear and easy explanation. I loved the Middle East because I wanted to know something true. First, though, it was all rebellion. Dad, a musician, Mom, a therapist, who both cared about people and liked new things. They had studied abroad and lived abroad and allowed me to choose any path I'd seek. They never forced one. When I was even younger, they didn't give me any authority to fight. If they told me not to watch TV, I would have watched it uninterrupted till I died. They didn't. They didn't give me any hard limit to push against. But the world did, later on. It said, as I heard it, "Don't go here." At the end of my first year of Arabic, Kanye's graduation dropped, and he said what I was thinking before every class. "Nuh-uh, you can't tell me nothing." In my bones, I felt that I was the product of 9/11. I couldn't say what that meant, but I knew that it had given me lenses to see the world and had shaped me like a parent. I was suspicious. Before I came to New York from the leafy Philadelphia suburbs, the city scared me with its chaos and possibility. I moved to New York to lock eyes with my boogeymen, for no reason I knew but to make the world expand. America was my suburb now, and there were voices all around that told me to stay within earshot. Yalla, into the wild. How could I live without an answer? What if they're all wrong? After graduation, I took the language pledge in the spirit of curiosity at a summer program in Oakland. For 10 weeks before I left for Abu Dhabi, I promised to speak only in Arabic. Just before I was to leave the continent unfettered, I met a girl there who would tether a part of me to it, and we were nearly dating before we ever said words in English. It was astonishingly easy to feel close when we accepted that we wouldn't dig for meaning in the minutiae of word choice and turns of phrase, as we would have on first dates in English. Masha and I were in just the right place to simply feel at each other. Says Rabin, Arabic is perfectly constructed for saying nothing with enormous eloquence. A language of pure manners in which there are hardly any literal meanings at all, and in which symbolic gesture is everything. Just as the words that follow sneezes in languages around the world are loosened from their literal meaning, the French to your wishes, the Pashto patience, Arabic back and forths often serve the connection far more than the dictionary. Something is said and heard, and meaning is made from the interaction. There is a single word, naiman, to greet the freshly shaved or recently showered. There is a common answer to any request, ala rasi, on my head. Words become gestures, and the roots are forgotten. Naiman comes from one of the many words for paradise, but it's silly to think paradise is invoked every time a friend trims his mustache. With only literature and textbook grammar to go on, though, we made our own symbolic gestures out of direct translations of American slang. The trouble, word-for-word renderings of what's up, what's cracking, yo dog, sound like total nonsense. And if we were really thinking in Arabic, calling each other dogs, unloved and thought unclean across the Arab worlds, should have been deeply offensive. The silliness was a welcome distraction from the truth, that we were getting no closer to learning how to say nothing, how to be eloquent in real live Arabic. We still said too much with every word. We shouted, "What is above my dog?" across the courtyard and thought it was hilarious. Masha and I both laughed at things like that and saw each other laughing. It was a star-crossed beginning after a night of Iraqi food in San Francisco. I continued to eat and drink with the abandon I had practiced all through college, and by the time we got home, I was vomiting and falling in love. Masha and I had sex in the way 21-year-olds do, and then, as people don't say but maybe should, the Trojan War was lost, and we might have been parents. I stumbled to the bathroom and puked. Not from fear or guilt, I don't think. Just from okra. It was Father's Day. I took Masha to a friend who took her to get Plan B, and we began our tumultuous courtship. It felt like we had skipped many of the wordy steps in the construction of American romances. Weeks later, as I boarded the plane to the Gulf, she was signing her emails with love. Carrot juice became cocktails, caviars and steak in my massage recliner between coral and diamond classes. And then, by the light of a red sunset above the clouds, I caught my first glimpse of the Gulf. And we descended, and the triangle of Abu Dhabi stuck out into the water like a slice of baklava. And dark came all of a sudden, eased by the moon not 2 hours from full, and the plane landed by the lights of the city. From me. Subject: Hello, hello. Monday at 12:38 a.m. You are like the Lewis to my Clarks. From Mosh. Reply: Hello, hello. Tuesday at 9:14 a.m. How will you brush your teeth without me? Love, Masha. Chapter 2. Abu Dhabi. I'm Sanjay. It was hot. Cresting 100 degrees in the evening steam, the air grabbed at my legs and chest, fogged camera lenses, and matted hair. Fire shot from the walls when I tested the first outlet of my new apartment, and I wandered my new neighborhood on Electra Street while I waited for the cheery electrician. As one old fable goes, a man is promised all the land he can walk in one day. If it were an Emirati story, the man would have won about half a block in the heat and traded it for a glass of tea. Soon enough, two Bangladeshi men came to replace the fuse. As soon as I could turn the lights on again, I turned them off and went to sleep. Fresh off the plane from California in 2010, I was a program coordinator for New York University, Abu Dhabi. My title meant nothing, and my employer's name looked like a paradox. Two incongruent place names pushed together without so much as a hyphen, bridging every cultural and temporal and physical divide with a flash of smart branding. Purple. Everything was purple. I coordinate programs, I'd explained to anyone who asked, a half-joke that left neither one of us more enlightened. It worked in Arabic, too. And then I would return to coordinating, or playing hooky, on the campus that claimed the essences of two cities and felt almost absolutely like neither. I'd never been anywhere in the Middle East, outside of family visits to Jerusalem and a 2-week jaunt to Morocco. I had studied the worlds that might be unlocked by Arabic, but they had never been real. And still, I was the guide to prospective faculty on tours to the refulgent Sheikh Zayed Grand Mosque, the world's 8th largest, besting their Omani neighbors in one of the region's favorite kinds of keeping up with the Joneses. There is room for 10,000 inside and 30,000 in the courtyard, and the nation's founding father rests nearby in a quietly locked mausoleum. It was magnificent, almost always. A blend of Mughal and Moorish styles selected from the palette of everything available. The white marble foyer with green vines inlaid, marble flowers. This was a Quranic interpretation of paradise. The white ceilings and towering pillars laced with gold, milk and honey. Here, the 99 names of God upon the wall that faces Mecca, with a blank spot for the name we cannot know until the end of time. If it seemed like I knew anything, the American professors would ask casually, "So, you're Muslim?" And I'd tell them the truth, hoping they'd laugh. Mosque tours from the unbar mitzvahed Jewish boy. "Look," I'd say, "the largest hand-woven carpet in the world, 2 billion stitches, shipped in 1,000 pieces from Iran. And look, the largest chandelier on planet Earth." Immense fruit-colored Swarovski baubles fixed to a kind of golden hat rack, dangling from one of 82 domes like Christmas decorations awaiting a tree. "From Germany." Other days, I might accompany someone like the university president's young cousin dune-bashing, off-roading in a heavy SUV on soft desert sand until I threw up, and then to an intercontinental buffet at an uncountably starred hotel with infinity pools onto the waterway at the city's edge. Months passed quickly. I wore suits to work, partly because it made me feel like I was doing something, and partly because it made other people think so too. Nights vanished like college evenings in a quiet neighborhood. Inside, I often forgot which side of the globe we were on, and I remembered only by smelling curry. It came, always, from a magical restaurant called Canopy, and I cultivated an easy addiction alongside Jake, a giant poet tutoring English, and with my neighbors Dan and Jordan, a couple from New Jersey and Atlanta via Brooklyn, university employees all. Not once did the saints of delivery judge me for my 4 packets of onion kulcha and chicken tikka masala. Not the day after raita and jalfrezi. Not the day after exactly the same. Some weeks, I called 6 times. For $5, the bag arrives at the door, delivered with gentleness and warm smiles that, even before opening, remind the delivery of where he is not. These were among the rare moments of glee I felt in the UAE. When anyone simply unplugged from Abu Dhabi, Canopy remained. On those nights, we watched TV shows from our native land. American Gladiators, Wipeout, all easy-to-digest slapstick with American budgets. But they were not shows I'd known before. Abu Dhabi became this to me. Memories of my country that weren't mine, and celestial Indian food. Sunday morning and the start of a new work week found me taking old business cards, restaurant coupons, and pharmacy memberships out of my wallet like someone checking into prison. "You won't need these in here." The vacuum of my all-white apartment in our hyper-clean new building rarely sparked memories of home. I had shipped over a piano keyboard whose keys I tickled the way a kid doodles in class, both because I was distracted and because I wanted to be. But when I turned it on, A smell conjured my childhood labors in the kitchen, mixing cookie dough with an overheating beater. This time, it was the scent of fizzled electronics and smoke. The keyboard adapter was not dual voltage. Some things are not so easily transformed. Luckily, my address on Electra Street was no joke. Down the kilometer-long block of Abu Dhabi's enormous grid, on the stretch between Old Airport Road and New Airport Road, 2nd and 4th Streets, there were no less than 15 shops selling appliances, miscellaneous electronics, cables. In the shadow of sprouting skyscrapers, they sat next to one another amicably, selling exactly the same things. But without fail, if they couldn't help, they'd send me one store to the left, then across the street, and on forever. An unsuccessful shopkeep would rarely let me leave without at least a spot of hope. And there is almost always hope in the land of the miscellaneous. People who do a little of everything are quite flexible. If they don't have a cable, they'll make it out of wire and pieces. If they don't know how to fix something, they'll try. Mumkin. In Arabic, the word maybe also means possible. I learned to haggle in the UAE even with reality's most intransigent features. Nothing was quite so certain as it was to the West, not even time. With a soft tone, you might push someone else to perceive it a little more like you do. "I'm 45 minutes away," the man stated. Fact, distance, time. "Could you make it 30? I asked. A friend told me to say that. She'd been here far longer than I had. The man came in 15. Everything was mumkin. I felt a bit like I had unlocked a secret of the universe, like Lucy Pevensey, who discovered a wardrobe that led to a land of lions and witches, or Arthur Dent, who learned that flying was learning to throw oneself at the ground and miss. The grammar of Arabia came one step further out of the shadows. Time may be the first thing to grow fuzzy in that latitude where there is not much difference between the seasons. When I landed in Abu Dhabi, the announcement to turn off electronic devices came 10 minutes earlier in Arabic than it did in English. There was less urgency in each minute. When I accepted that another's logic simply wouldn't follow the rules, I knew my anger could fade toward those who had been breaking them. In my state of, call it peninsulation, the island took on its own logic. Insulation does many things, especially in the blinding heat of a hot island off an equally hot peninsula. Most emerge from the tumble dry of Abu Dhabi immigration and find their matches, American with American, Indian with Indian, like paired socks. It is a melting pot where nothing ever melts. In this uniquely modern frontier town, we had all come for some piece of the riches. After 2 decades of scouting, oil was struck at sea in 1958. Now the UAE claims reserves of 98 billion barrels, enough at current rates to last a neat century. Almost all of it is to be tapped from the Emirate of Abu Dhabi, 8% of the world's black gold under a footprint the size of West Virginia. Censuses are fuzzy, but high birth rates and unprecedented immigration have multiplied the UAE population about 40-fold since independence in 1971. The world's population has only doubled. And yet, a sense of belonging is not forthcoming in the UAE, where the jobs are, but where 85% of the bulging resident society are not and will never become citizens. Perhaps that's what makes it feel so free for some. A summer fling with no expectations, no commitment. For others, it is a more pointed reminder that they are subjects, fully beholden to the whims of the monarchy. Either way, the UAE has no path to citizenship for its foreign labor force, and so we reach out for the communities that remind us of home. While we reach out laterally for comfort, the country stacks us into neatly color-coded strata. We were stratified nationally here and stratified by the shades of our skin. Construction recruiters fill workers' city apartments 14 to a room with men from the Indian subcontinent, a moniker all too consonant with their role as a subclass. From Southeast Asia come maids, Sri Lanka, Indonesia, and the hospitality industry's front office, Philippines. East Africans do security. Arabs from Lebanon and Egypt handle security as well, own restaurants, and mingle more fluidly, but remain a step apart. Businesses pull from each of these, but white-collar jobs are filled overwhelmingly with Europeans and Americans, and within each business a microcosm of the social order is noticeable, as if described by lines of invisible ink. At the top of it all, there are Emiratis, the spontaneous kings of their own land. As a nation, they are self-made. As individuals, they are largely reliant on the National Trust. When we sought connection within these castes, the structure made it so that we were even more likely to grab on to likenesses of ourselves. The university, though it would organize itself by many of the same principles, began with different premises. It piled students and most of its employees, but not the drivers or subcontracted security or lower-level staff, into what was then the tallest residential building in the city. Insofar as we knew who our floor mates were, we were offered the chance to connect. My dearest friend, Iman, was an NYU grad from Pakistan, half Venezuelan, and fully too kind and honest to keep her head above the flow of office drama and bureaucratic bullshit. We spent most evenings with Gila, a half-Iranian, half-Mauritian mother of two, raised in London and Paris, with more spirit for nightlife than I could ever muster. We went to ladies' nights with the Kenyan and Dominican contingents. We made pancakes and drained bottles of Bailey's into our coffee with Jake, the 6'2" poet from Erie, kitty corner from me across Pennsylvania, and a travel partner to places we knew nothing about. Later, I'd escaped the Emirates with Neil from Iowa, a fellow member of the tribe, that is to say, the Jewish one, which had never mattered much to me except as permission to make jokes of a certain kind. On the university's opening day, when the inaugural class arrived from six continents, I met Trital Oleg from Kaliningrad, a little Russian exclave separated from the motherland by the Baltic states. Newly isolated, by varying levels of choice, from what we knew, we formed young relationships in a young country. They hatched as in high school, some de facto friendships from sufficiently shared schedules, others more deliberate. At times, one became the other. Jake and I ordered from Canopy and drank vodka tonics on long lunch breaks on slow days, which were many. We breezed through the side entrance and out the side exit of African and Eastern wine and spirits, never once needing the alcohol license by which non-Muslim residents are permitted the purchase of 20% of their monthly salary in alcohol. You must be of legal drinking age and a non-Muslim to visit the African Eastern website. We hauled the loot that clanked in black bags past the storefront with equally black windows, down 7th Street, named Sheikh Zayed the First Street, but called Khalidia Street, until it crossed the 10 smooth lanes of Airport Road and became Electra. Up the elevators home. The grid of modern Islamic architecture below could not have been anywhere else we'd ever lived. But it was easy then to forget every reason we had come here. Early October, and it is 93 degrees by the pool. The beaches along the corniche are lapped with warm, salty seawater, overprotected from the counterclockwise current of the Gulf by the breakwater and the 1,050-acre Alulu Island that men made by scooping up the ocean floor. It looks beautiful. 7 miles of untouched shoreline, some facing jet skis at the Abu Dhabi skyline from a flattering distance, some opening onto the turquoise strait. But access, since 2009, is by private boat only. I'm almost comfortable, but I'm restless. I'm too comfortable. I notice myself growing accustomed to the last-minute grocery deliveries, a bottle of Coke, an egg, two tomatoes, that materialized from the store one elevator ride and 15 steps away. I am ready for Mustafa to come and ask for dry cleaning, to whisk it away and return it folded and hung. Over 16 months, I would never know where this magic was done. The culture of the Emirates is so defined by its stratification that one draw for white Westerners is the instant shift in social standing awarded just for showing up. In the evenings, whether from a smelly taxi or a blacked-out Maserati, we guests arriving at hotels, the homes of many high-end restaurants and bottomless brunch spots, of bars and nightclubs and a large share of the things to do, are sorted immediately by the style of our costume, coveralls, jeans, suit, kandura, and the color of our skin. "Good evening, sir," the African doorman says to me, with something just short of a wink. He knew me well. Hundreds of me had already arrived at the Royal Meridian that night. This is the comfort for some. Families, working mothers and fathers, immigrants from places where no amount of long hours ever earned anything close to a wink from the doorman. But I haven't earned the sirs, not when I show up in matted Jufro and a t-shirt. And I know that if I'm getting it for free, just like the free cheeses at the trendy cafe by the conference center, someone else isn't. Even at the very top, life could seem compartmentalized, preordained, immobile. The United Arab Emirates is one of the world's two elective monarchies. The other is Malaysia. Every 5 years, the Supreme Council, the rulers of each of the seven emirates, picks the president, who will also hold the offices of Supreme Commander of the Armed Forces and chairman of both the Supreme Petroleum Council and the Supreme Council itself, and the vice president from among their own. Historically, the president has always been the ruler of Abu Dhabi, the capital, and the vice president has always been the ruler of Dubai, both hereditary posts. Even for the living sheikhs I could see in the pictures along the highway, in the banks, the supermarket, behind the front desk of every hotel, there would be no movement outside those frames. Despite all the metaphors about shifting sands, deserts are a place of supreme consistency. But, and yet, there was something I felt close to, thrillingly, for the first time. I had not expected Lawrence's Arabia when I deplaned in this desert, but I felt like we had made it to his foyer. Here were planted the stories to follow. The 4/5 of us sweating without citizenship were exactly what made the whole national enterprise feel rootless, but looking closely, it was exactly this coalition of rainbow passports that brought the Gulf to absurd life unlike anywhere else in the world. The curries at Canopy brought me over the sea to the south. Cabbies from the hill behind Tora Bora gave hints of their homes in the White Mountains. Endless falafel and fresh hummus by delivery whisked me over Arabia Deserta across the Great Carrot to sketches of Damascus. The hodgepodge was a grip on the otherwise frictionless city. I loved everything that was confusing, for in that confusion there was something to look for, something to dig around. I loved the haggling that gave us Lawrences without a cause, something to fight for. I loved the addresses for the 2.5 million residents in Abu Dhabi, as landmark-based as my grandmother's directions. There were no street numbers, and official road names were hardly used. Instead of 1500 Rashid bin Said Al Maktoum Street, you'd ask for the road formerly known as Airport Road behind Domino's Pizza. This seemed the greatest hope against a fading heritage. Listen to any cab driver. He not only speaks of the past, he drives you right through it. After I left, the roads were renamed and numbered, but it hasn't stuck. The cabbies still use the old names, Gila wrote me later, so it's useless having new addresses. While I lived on Electra Street, our new skyscraper, Sama Tower, began to develop landmark status among the taxi community. I once heard ominously that it was built atop a graveyard, unmarked as they typically are according to Islamic tradition. At 50 stories, named from Arabic for sky or heaven, Sama was very briefly the tallest residential building in the city. Soon, something else sprouted higher on man-made land. Out its back entrance to Foodland's Falafel, across from the new Muslim center and behind the new medical center in the infinite web of parking lots that act like side streets within the city's oversized grid, I met Ali from Dara, a mid-sized city an hour north of Damascus. Sometimes I went for a sandwich and to say hi, other times I went to say hi and have a sandwich. Ya Ali! Adam! Kifek Adam! After months of that, I felt like we knew each other. My age, exactly with black hair and a white uniform, Ali had bright eyes and a smile that could cook rotisserie. He manned the falafel and shawarma nightly, shaving chicken or lamb from the spinning poles according to customer demand. Regular, or the chili-spiced meat collage called Mexiki. He greeted me with such loyalty that I thought of him like an old friend, and felt guilty when I had been too absent. Arabic makes it easy. If a young man isn't Akhi, my brother, he is Habibi, my dear, like every friend or foe, man, woman, and child across the Arab world. At Foodlands, Our Arabic moments felt like connections, the beginning of something. His first language to my second. It wasn't the novelty of practicing a school subject on anyone who understood, like discussing pressing options with Mustafa, the dry cleaning deliverer, in his fourth language. That just let me feel far away. But a brother should know true things, and Ali and I never spoke about anything important for long. Kifek? Kif omak wabuk? How are you? How's your mother? Your father? He'd ask, rolling pickled carrot and chilies into the pita. Alhamdulillah, I said, the only response possible. The praise God that subsumes all states and feelings. Say more if you'd like, but the whole range of human emotion can be contained in its lilt. Kif ailtek? How's your family? Alhamdulillah. And I'd grin, and wish I had the words to say more, and wander off into the night, $2 lighter. And when that wasn't enough, when I felt those connections were far too flimsy to hitch me to the real city, I pretended I was in paradise. I pulled a towel from the door handle of my drunkenly designed bathroom, a miniature shower stall alone in a large room, and spent 2 shawarmas worth on a 5-minute cab to the beach. It was winter where my friends lived. It was hot, and I had found enough change on the nightstand to cover the ride. The walk was never pleasant anyway, across pedestrian intersections where 8-lane roads merged. It was safe enough at the crosswalks. Cars followed all the rules because the city was built for them. Everything is 2 aspects. You know, everything is 2 sides, the driver said on the way. I blinked. A woman passed at the crosswalk. Take this lady now. I say to her, Habibi, go. Yes? That, Habibi, is the ubiquitous corsage upon the already well-dressed Arabic language. This is the best word. My heart is clear. But, he said, this is the worst word. The bad word also. Habibi could be used to cajole, to deceive, to misrepresent the speaker with an unclear heart. You're confused, he laughed. I swore I wasn't. Not enough to give up. While the oppressive heat of the summer months barred most activity but pressing elevator buttons, winter in the Gulf had space for thought. We navigated each other's accents, his turning P's into F's and losing V's among the frontal vowels, dusted with Arabic where nothing else would do. Kharban, he said, to describe a bad person. The word means something like ruined, but sounds so much more like it means it. He was like the Madonna of cab drivers, only one name written on the screen that beeped and spoke when we topped the speed limit. Liaqat. It means light, he said. He picked up his phone from the console. This is a mobile, yes? This is the good thing. If you use for the good thing, this is the best thing. If you use this for bad, this is the worst thing. It's depend on you. I nodded. The aspect was a function of our intention and our action. No object was innately good or bad. We passed new glass towers germinating along the Corniche Road. A person, though, could be just Kharban. Listen, I'm from Pakistan, from Peshawar. I do something bad. Listen. Then you not think Pakistan is bad, you only think this man is bad, yes? Yes. If I say this country is bad, then myself I am bad. The important thing, said Liaqat, was that we mean what we say. Then, at least the words are good. As I moved to slide out of the car, Liaqat soliloquized at someone out the window. Habibi, he said, followed by something in Pashto. Was that a good Habibi or bad Habibi? You know, he said with a wink. The sand is dredged up from the gulf floor and plopped along the Corniche beach, too fine and too pure. There is no seaweed or rocks, no driftwood along the coast. Marina Mall sits on the breakwater across a stretch of oversalted water that can't circulate, adorned with a huge Emirati flag waving from what was once the world's largest flagpole. It is now the 4th largest. In this department, the Emirates has faltered in keeping up with the Al Sauds. All he needed was the genie's robes, and Liaquat would have made the perfect cabby guru, a stock figure in his uniform. I hailed a cab the next day, and lo, there was Liaquat, in the flesh, in the exact same of Abu Dhabi's 10,000 grey cabs.
What? Huh? I asked.
He didn't look at all surprised. These accidents were the happiest magic, unplanned, like all the best things in the Emirates. Halfway down the Al Ain truck road to the oasis city at the Omani border, runoff from a wastewater treatment plant collects against the highway. The freshwater pool now attracts thousands of pink flamingos, just passing through like the rest of us, on their migratory circle from Russia around Azerbaijan toward Iran. Clinging to their legs for hundreds of miles, little passengers have fallen off into the pool. There are now tiny shrimp in the heart of the desert. Before 1961, Abu Dhabi didn't have a single paved road. Then, unfathomable wealth. Instantly, there were resources for the ruler's aspirations and, as if selected from a catalogue, cities sprang up in the Emirates from absolute nothing. In this new nation without citizens, starting from scratch is the national pastime. For those of us lured to the Gulf, not tricked, we could be anyone we wanted. It even gave me options. I answered calls from India, from Senegal, from every emirate asking if I wanted something or if I had something. With language getting in the way, I wasn't ever sure of a single answer I gave until they asked, "Sanjay?" "No," I'd say. "This isn't Sanjay." Twice a week for my entire life in the Emirates, I answered calls for Sanjay. "This still isn't him," I'd say. Some days, I could hardly persuade them that they had the wrong number. It wasn't a wrong number after all. Just wrong timing. In a past life, those 10 digits were his. He was in the finance business, it seemed, or he tended to leave our phone number somewhere bankers could find it. Sometimes, the caller never knew they had the wrong man. To this day, I retain contacts at almost every bank in Arabia. In the early days of my employment, one conversation began like many. I was assisting the university's procurement department in a job that felt very Middle Eastern. I called vendors, delinquent in their side of whatever bargain, and begged them to make good. Chairs, ping pong tables, laboratory equipment. No tracking numbers here. Just tracking people. "What is your good name?" said a man who introduced himself as Rafiq on the other end of the line. "Adam."
"Arif?"
"Adam."
"Arif?"
"Adam." He took a moment to process this.
"Arif."
"Yes," I said. And then we attempted to do business. Certainty and inflexibility tend to close down in this part of the world, the Westerner's term for the geographical cloud that is settled unintelligibly wide over the region. It implies the freedom we have within it, the haziness of borders, names, everything, and that the men from the subcontinent do not. In many cases, it was irrelevant who I was. By asserting less, I could learn more. I could converse in symbolic gesture. And I could find out what happened to the storage cabinets from mid-August. And I wondered if there was anything so certain about myself that I could not deny it to strangers with a touch of accent, new clothes, better posture. Really, I was only taking a page out of the city's book. Abu Dhabi itself expands onto landfill, surpassing the past boundaries of the island it is built upon. In the last 40 years, the city has increased its surface area by a sixth. The Sheraton Corniche, once beachfront, is now almost 1,000 feet from the water. It's a common practice from Battery Park City in New York to Hong Kong. Masha's hometown Boston has more than doubled in size since its founding in 1640, and every time it reflects a kind of enterprising audacity of man asserting himself over the wild. The process is called land reclamation, as if this is how it once was, even though the new territory was never anything but sea or swamp. It is reclaimed so that we begin to forget what was old and what was new, what was authentic and what was an adaptation. And it works. Soon, after those decades of construction, there is no difference. I never knew what the beach would have looked like with driftwood. The old limits are erased by the ebb of the new high tide. In one of the barber shops near Saloon Tariq and Saloon Wave Beach and Shahrazad Fadl Gents Saloon, subscribers to a kind of nationwide typo, the Sri Lankan barber was insistent about my sideburns. "I'll give you the style." "No, thank you. Just neatened up a bit." "It's the style." "Please, just the most normal trim." "You don't want the style?" "No." I felt guilty that I wasn't giving him a proper canvas for his talents, but I felt freer as something simple, vague. "I'm American," I said, hoping that might count as an excuse. He shrugged like a cashier watching me buy the world's tackiest wedding ring. But he couldn't hold back. In 10 minutes, I saw South Asian artistry plastered to my face. The hair on my head was chopped short against the heat, and my sideburns tapered, curving ever so daintily into little peaks. I never got another haircut in the country. The more my hair grew curlier and long, the more it betrayed my foreign roots. When I put the phone down and walked the 8-lane Abu Dhabi roads, I became something more rigid. This is the up and down side of American, the loudest branding label in the world. Pointy sideburns or no, my hair and face and clothes walked 10 steps ahead of me and always spoke first. That was the limit on what I could be. In brief moments of possible connection, there was baggage. It was too hard to start afresh because nothing was ever fresh. I struggled with that. Emiratis did too. On a small street behind our apartment that wound around a juice shop, I sat on the curb with Khulood, a fellow administrator at the university. I felt tighter with her than I did with any other Emirati women, if only because we'd talked the most. And it always seemed easier to talk to Emirati women than Emirati men. We held juices named for the Burj Al Arab, the sail-shaped ultra-luxury hotel in Dubai that wears a helipad like a sailor's cap. Khulood was from Dubai, and whenever she told people so, she saw hands beginning to outstretch, envy and need and a rare brush with riches. When she was abroad, she felt like she was a sounding board for ignorance and instantly a potential patron to everyone's dreams. "So I came up with Merchi," Khulood said. "Merchi is off of the coast of Yemen. It is an island." I said. "It is?" "No." Her head flew back as she laughed at me, and she teased her headscarf forward. "So when people would ask, 'Where are you from?' I'd say, 'I'm from Merchi.' 'Oh, Merchi, where is that?' I'm like, 'It's an island in Yemen.' And that's just how the conversation ends." I'd always wanted to do that. Too curious to see reactions to what I actually was, I had never let my imagination run so wild. But how wonderful to be blank. It was great from there on. No conversations, no more questions. I easily became someone both fixed and disconnected. I experimented with identities that were vague enough to take root in something I didn't understand. And at first, it didn't bother me. It was all so American, I thought, to be this kind of self-made man. Once, the ballet came to Abu Dhabi. 10 minutes by grey taxi down the waterfront boulevard, I went to see them at the Emirates Palace. The towering blonde freshman, Oleg, arranged tickets for 2 dozen students and staff from a Russian contact at a good price. In classic Russian fashion, the man had sold 500 more tickets than there were seats in the Emirates Palace auditorium. In classic Middle Eastern fashion, there was always another way in. And as always in the Emirates, there were extra seats despite it all. Around the other side of the theater, I fell into line behind one of their highnesses in the black and gold overrobe as they glided across the red carpet. I babbled nonsense into my phone and stayed close. I came back out to Oleg's door from the inside and began to usher our group in by the handful. "Let's go. There isn't time." The women at the door looked confused and upset. One Russian, one Arab under a headscarf. but they wouldn't block the way. The Russian's eyes narrowed. I started saying things in Arabic.
Yalla, istajilu.
The women scowled at me as the students began to play along, squeezing past.
Who are they? Do you speak Russian?
Arabi, English, Ruski, whichever, I said. I spoke no Russian. Oleg filed in with some others. Хорошо, I said to him, and interrupted myself like I had more Russian words to say. In the short moments the women tried to figure out what kind of an asshole I was, more students passed through. The confusion tactic is a beautiful one, more commonly used on the defensive than as such a brazen sortie, but desperate times had called. I turned to the Arab woman to say a few words in a different language. They are very important guests of the Sheikh. This isn't good, I said.
Which Sheikh? She asked.
But then they had all gone in and found places, and I looked hurriedly at my phone and said, oh, and disappeared back among the gold-colored seats. I don't know what it was about the Emirates Palace that made it feel like the perfect playground for these kinds of shenanigans. Maybe it was its name, a 7-star luxury hotel that was not, in fact, a royal residence. The presidential palace was under construction down the road. Maybe it was the magical look of all that gold, 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 and diamonds that made reality melt away and made me feel like we could all start from scratch. Every so often, that was where I played second trumpet in the now-dissolved UAE Philharmonic Orchestra. After a concert, we carried our instruments up from the auditorium to the central cafe that serves a $15 old-fashioned and cappuccinos peppered with gold leaf that tastes exactly like you'd expect hammered thin soft metals to taste. Luscious leather couches facing glass cases of French patisserie. A South African trio jammed under a 6-days-a-week contract until 11. It was against the rules for a fourth to join in, especially brass, but I took the hotel employee's begrudging shrug as something else.
Blame me, I said. If anyone makes trouble, just tell them to blame me.
I can't, he said, eyeing my trumpet.
But we never talked, I said.
Who are you? I looked back at the rows of macaron and millefeuille. No one who knew me was looking.
I'm Sanjay.
Onyx on piano was happy to let me play a few choruses over Mannenberg, a South African tune I half remembered from high school, and I took off like no one was listening. I knew the key, but I didn't know the chord changes underneath, the harmonic framework of the song, its house rules for improvisation. This is like knowing words in a language without grammar, like furnishing a house without knowing the floor plan. I danced over the rules until a wrong note would tell me that I'd broken one, and then I'd float again. It was shallow, and I couldn't refer to the deepest roots of the piece because I didn't know them, but it was something. It might have been the freest I ever felt in that country on the beach, and it was all forbidden. There, like anywhere, I could violate the rules by not understanding or by deliberately ignoring them. In the airport, an ad for Swiss watches said, to break the rules, you must first master them. But you cannot master the rules of the Emirates, and we existed in a state of constant bending. The chord changes of the country, the cultural, religious, historical roots that still hold sway, are hard to find, and so I felt like we were just skimming the surface, ready to drift off into nothingness. We were, to a point. But if I loved the place, which, damn it, I was starting to if only because I was beginning to know it, and which is different from wanting to live there, then I would rejoice with the truth when I found it, and hope for the best until then. In tiny bursts, the country revealed itself. One Friday morning, I packed into a van of Americans at dawn for the Al-Wathba camel racetrack. It was the first day of camel racing season. Think of all the glamour, the maquillage, the frenzied betting and crowd screaming, the graceful galloping of horse races. It's none of that. Some 1,000 gangly camels run dozens at a time in back-to-back races around a horseshoe track nearly 5 miles long. Owners shadow their entries in crammed white land cruisers from an internal track, paved that season for the very first time. While the driver speeds ahead in what looks from the inside like rush hour in the desert, the owner clicks a remote control that triggers the camel's whip. Oh, right. They're ridden by robots. Little boxes and hats cling to the speeding camels just behind the hump, spinning whips on command. It's a great improvement. In the middle of the desert, 30 miles east of Abu Dhabi, camel breeders emancipated child jockeys in favor of their no-frills droid replacements. Handlers pull the camels through as the starting gate shoots up, some animals, still losing their way, turning against the tide and racing back toward home. Others somehow escape the track and, foaming at the mouth from exertion, charge unsuspecting bystanders looking through camera lenses. Still, the radio reception is no great shakes, as we punned when drunk or tired, and owners must be nearly within earshot of their camels to use their whip remotes. Of course, I wanted to be part of the action. So did Nils, my friend and colleague who, because the world is small and loves jokes, was Masha's former classmate at her 120-kid high school in Boston. It took but a friendly, "Can we?" and a hand on the door handle to be invited in to race around with an owner and his driver. Our first hosts were consistently in second-to-last place and drove in a serious, subdued silence. But after one lap, Nils and I managed to land seats in the media van. An announcer rattled off names and standings to the radio, as frenzied as an auctioneer. Unfortunately, it seemed camels weren't christened as creatively as racehorses, because their owners didn't tipple, I joked. Pulling in at dawn, owners raced these camels out at the racetrack, drinking coffee in their cars from paper cups filled by Iranian men wearing traditional garb and daggers. When Abu Dhabi struck oil and tailors rushed to sew deeper pockets into every dishdash, city dwellers found more things to buy, shinier things to polish, and bigger things to invest in. But in the immutable desert, there is only desert. Men whose fathers raised and raced camels continue to raise and race camels, only now with a little more land. We reached the end of the race, accepted Capri Sun juice bags from the announcer, and settled in for another lap. In Arabic, every other day is named for its order in the week, but Friday is Yom al-Jumu'ah, from a root that means gathering. No doubt it referred to gathering at the mosque, the Jama, for communal Friday prayers, but it became, or has always been, a day for many other kinds of communion. The more I lost track of myself, the more I gravitated toward gatherings. They all pulled. Anywhere it seemed like people came together, not by accident or for money, but because they knew one another and they wanted to. This was what I felt I needed. One day per week across the rough triangle of the UAE, on Friday, gathering day, veils of sterility lift. After the camels finish their galumphing rounds, 100 miles away in Dubai, 1,000 South Asians are convening in a huge ring around a sandy lot to complete in Palwani. They come from every emirate in the hour before sunset to watch this style of wrestling, brought to the UAE by their compatriots in the 80s. Men strip down to brightly colored briefs, a jester-like promoter bangs a drum and plays a nasal horn, and crowd favorites and newcomers take to the dirt. At the same moment, just over the Hejr Mountains in Fujairah, families are gathering at another rough arena by the sea. This one is for bullfighting, or rather, bull-butting. Here, men do not challenge bulls to the death. A fearless man with a switch persuades bulls to challenge each other to the point of dishonor. Bulls never die. They can only lose. Emirati men in all-white robes, the Arabian thob, called dishdash here and elsewhere in the Gulf, called kandura only here, pull the animals close with ropes until they lock horns. Children plop down just behind a thin fence installed only recently. Others lean out of their sunroofs or lounge in folding chairs with bags of snacks. A candy man with only sweets peddles his stock. The tidiness of UAE life is displaced here by a shock of chaos, a messy spectacle with glory for the taking and tradition older than the buildings. Fujairah is among the smaller and poorer of the seven emirates, with no huge oil reserves or financial havens, just morsels handed down from the national coffers that are filled in Abu Dhabi and largely tapped by the capital's favorite relatives in Dubai. I couldn't be sure what laws of the land I was learning when a one-ton Brahmin bull escaped the ring and charged into the parking lot, pursued by a train of men in spotless white. But we all jumped, and I felt a little giddy, like I'd heard my grandmother curse. For that split second, I glimpsed the nation's roots. All the while, bored Fujairans screeched by hanging off the back of their roaring ATVs, looping up and down the Corniche Road, and making people frown. In 1922, archaeologist D.G. Hogarth reported, "Social differences have always been less in Arabia than perhaps anywhere else, not only between one community and another, but between one class and another in one community." Hogarth, mentor to T.E. Lawrence, wrote that before the oil, before the apartments were filled four parts to one with foreigners. It could hardly stand in greater contrast now, with the nation's reputation for unearthly wealth and the squalid treatment of the labor class. And yet, on these Fridays on the dirt where everyone was welcome, you could see it. The community, the mixed crowds all looking in the same direction. And then the sun sets, and we retreat again to our separate villas. Once every year, right on cue, the strata dissolve nationwide for one night. Eid Saeed, we wish each other. Happy holiday. Diwali has passed. It's not Islamic New Year yet. It's not Hanukkah, although it sometimes is. It's not Christmas, even if the buildings all draped in merry and glittering Yuletide neon suggest otherwise from every window. On the 2nd of December, the UAE comes alive for National Day. My first year marked the 39th anniversary of the unification of the Seven Emirates, an occasion commemorated by the only tradition befitting its significance, shooting silly string from spray cans in strangers' faces. 39. In people years, the last crossroad before a great transformation, a faintly depressing maturity. But the UAE celebrates its youth with unabashed pride and its age as an accomplishment. Its 40th would be just the same, just as messy. Up and over the Gulf of Aqaba, they played with aerosol too, in that country ripening past 65. It's like Israeli Independence Day, I thought quietly to myself. At the best moments, it's pandemonium. Abu Dhabi car owners en masse relieve their vehicles of their mufflers, burning rubber and backfiring on the busiest street in the city. The Corniche Road, which runs from the port past the beaches and the billboard for Our Father Zayed and up to the driveway of Emirates Palace, is at a standstill, as if anyone would be anywhere else. Thousands rev engines and blare music from trucks painted red, white, green, and black, arrayed with faces of the sheikhs and overflowing with garlands and streamers. Exhaust pipes howl under pressure, letting out bursts that sound like automatic gunfire from a distance and almost feel like it up close. Friends ride in pickups or huge flatbeds, shaking them until they almost capsize. Others dance in circles in the street. Fireworks are exploding all the time, and everyone is shooting everyone in the face. Roaming salesmen sell cans of colored silly string for 5 dirham, around $1.35, and passengers in or on top of cars fire back with a vengeance. Beware the accomplices riding shotgun and brandishing shotgun-like water guns. Some shoot string, others shoot water. Many shoot a kind of bathtub foam that fills the air and sticks to clothes. It's every national resident for himself. And tonight, if you want to be, you can be a national too. With a can of string, I attacked a car through its open window, and 4 men exploded from the doors. I was drowned in soap, a clear defeat, witnessed by the line of bystanders along the sidewalk who watched battles unfold as you would from a saloon porch at high noon. On December 2nd, soap scrubs away distinctions between owner and renter, laborers and locals of leisure, leaving those who go home to wash in palaces as vulnerable as the crowds. Maserati drivers with open windows suffer sneak attacks, and clever infantry shoot soapy jets through sunroofs. The more you own, the more you have to get covered in string and spume. Yet in this chaos, there is a code. A wild Middle Eastern gunslinger's rulebook. I stand rattling my can streetside, armed only with the power to intimidate and get foamed in the nose. A car drives by. A Pakistani man sticks his head out of the window, holding his can. He turns his hand over and back. Empty? I'm empty. Shoot you next year. Dawn rises again over the corniche. The street cleaners have already washed the roads and lifted the trash from the grassy islands, as if Rumpelstiltskin had come in the night to do the impossible job. What will we owe in the end for this magic? The transient unity of the UAE fades again, and communities drift further apart. Luckily, the day after was a Friday. Yom al-Jamu'ah. The best day on which the sun has risen is Friday, Muhammad is quoted as saying in the hadith. On it, Adam was created. On it, he was made to enter paradise. On it, he was expelled from it. 2 weeks later, two men came to visit us bearing the unique scent of home in their scraggly beards. They both took off their baseball caps, and underneath them, yarmulkes. Dressed and bearded to the nines of Hasidic custom, these two Chabad rabbis had come via Dubai from Brooklyn to light Hanukkah candles with relocated Jews on the 40th floor of our brand new apartment building, where everyone I knew lived stacked on top of one another. I hardly thought of myself as a Jew in this place. Jewish, sure, but I felt about my Jewishness the way you might feel about being left-handed. To those who knew me, I was a white American. To those who didn't and saw me in a suit, I lived somewhere in the spectrum of well-situated tan. But for tonight, I belonged to the Jews by dint of ancient nationality. I didn't know who had invited the Orthodox rabbis to Sama, but I sure as hell was going to go. Not out of Jewishness, and not for the religious community that wasn't mine, but because, sweet Mary and Joseph, we were going to have a real Hanukkah shindig high above the mosques and down sweet manischewitz above the teetotaling desserts. Rabbi Shuki and Rabbi Yisrael led the blessings, touching the shamas to five candles, now burning brightly with the green light from the minarets below. It was the fifth night of Hanukkah, nicknamed the darkest night, for falling every year on the new moon. Although the lunisolar Hebrew calendar prevents it from ever falling on the Sabbath, the week's most holy day, the fifth night is distinctly holy. The rabbis resolved the paradox. Clearly, this day must need no help to get holier. We all reflected in the polished tile under fluorescent lights. All around us, we perceived Gentile expatriatism and an image of Islam in low resolution. I felt the contrast not as a mark of oppression, but one of distinction. What made us run-of-the-mill deli patrons in New York now made us bakers of homemade bagels and fasters at unpredictable seasons. We were Jews, and with shared distinction comes a kind of solidarity, a kind of fort-like refuge. I didn't want to build a moat. However much we welcomed one another in, I feared keeping the outside out. But with blessed juices flowing, chocolate coins clinking against the tile floor, and kids screaming at their dreidels, I slipped into the comfort of familiar things. For a moment, the impulse to do something quieted. The wandering urge slowed, and I began to feel attached. It was a more Jewish gathering than I'd ever gone to in Pennsylvania, where we did lip service to the high holidays and moved quickly on to the wine. This was my great-grandfather's territory, where Soviet identity cards considered Jew a nationality. For me, it was like I'd come home to a home I'd never known. I don't always look white, but I check it on boxes. And within the standard boxes, Jewishness conflates concepts of ethnicity, call it race, and religion, and even nationality in the straightforward sense. To the unfamiliar, Jewish and Israeli often substitute for each other. When did your family come from Israel? Though none of the people who made me had ever lived there. But to tangle it all more, I had family.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.